Welcome to the broadcast. I'm David Feldman. It's Pledge Week here in beautiful, sunny California. So we've been asked to put together some highlights from 2011. We want to share them with you. On today's program, we look back at some, not all, but some of our favorite bits of 2011 with Martin Short, Andrea Martin, and Robert Smigel. And while you're looking for a gift this holiday season, if you have room in your home and your heart, run down to the nearest shelter and adopt the ugliest cat or dog you can find. And former President Ronald Reagan stops by to discuss his upcoming centennial birthday. But first, this word from Universal Pictures.
This summer, from the people who brought you the King's Speech.
It's my husband, the King. I'm afraid that once again he's required to speak publicly.
That shouldn't be a problem. As you know, I've been rather successful in helping the King overcome his stammer.
Well, this time it's not the stammer I'm worried about.
Comes the story of a monarch.
We're going to need every last one of your unorthodox methods of speech therapy.
Your Majesty, what are you trying to say?
With a mouthful of s***.
I'm afraid the King has Tourette's.
It's the King's Speech 2, talking dirty. And all your favorites are back. There's Colin Firth as King George VI.
If I can't address the nation by the time I go to damn it!
Jeffrey Rush as quirky Australian speech therapist Lionel Logue.
I do believe kings are meant to have turrets, not Tourette's. Get it, Your Majesty.
And introducing Otis, the King's pet minor bird.
You Australian mother! Holly wants a blow!
Shut your bloody beak before I kick your.
I couldn't have said it better myself, Your Majesty.
Come see a film with humor, drama, and more British swearing than Christian Bale on a six-day meth bender. The King's Speech 2, Talking Dirty, coming this summer to a theater near you.
Well, this assignment is shaping up to be a royal pain in the butt.
This week, Comcast celebrated the FCC's approval of their merger with NBC by announcing their purchase of C-SPAN.
Tonight on the new Comcast C-SPAN, forget the storm outside and hunker down with hearings from the Exploratory Committee on Interstate Commerce. Then on Comcast C-SPAN Late Night, Brian Lamb welcomes guests, co-chair of the Senate Committee for Homeland Security and Government Affairs, Susan Collins, and from Modern Family, Ty Burrell. It all happens tonight on the new Comcast C-SPAN.
This weekend, President Ronald Reagan celebrates his 100th birthday. I spoke with him earlier today. Mr. Reagan, thank you for joining us.
My pleasure, Mr. Reagan.
And sir, how are you feeling?
Never felt deader in my life. That's Buddy Rich is helping me out here. A little faster, Buddy.
Congratulations on your centennial, sir.
Well, that's not all, Mike. I also turned 100 this week.
Well, you know, a lot of people are honoring your memory this weekend.
My what?
Yeah, they're honoring your memory this weekend.
Oh, yes. As a matter of fact, they're calling it Super Bowl Sunday. Go, Ronnie, go.
Looking back at your legacy, sir, what are you most proud of?
I'd have to say defeating the evil empire and ending the era of big government.
And what would you say is your biggest regret?
Failing to defeat the evil empire and putting an end to the era of big government. I don't know if that deserved a rim shot, but not.
Now, what about people who say you ushered in an era of cruelty and heartlessness?
Please, let's leave my wife Nancy out of this.
No, sir. Sir, sir. Sir. Sir.
Yes. Yes.
Sir. Sir. Yes. Sir, I'm not talking about your wife Nancy. I'm talking about the media who said that you were indifferent to the needs of those less fortunate.
Oh, well, let's leave my adopted son, what's his name, out of this.
It's Michael, sir.
Oh, well, thank you, Michael.
Let's talk about the cover of Time magazine, Barack Obama.
Gesundheit.
Believe it or not, many... sir? Believe it or not, many people are seeing parallels between Obama and you.
Well, Jane Wyman always had a little of the jungle fever. Is that what you mean?
Thank you for joining us, Mr. President.
Well, thank you, Jimmy, and all your viewers, and Merry Christmas. And oh, and one more thing, if I could just say also to you, to all your viewers.
Yes.
May.
Just go ahead, sir.
May.
Mr. President, what is it that you'd like to say? There was something you wanted to tell our viewers.
Tonight on the new Comcast C-SPAN, the weather is cold, but Sarah Palin is hot. Tonight, she puts the A in Q&A. Then live from the Hart Office Building, the Senate Committee on Energy and Natural Resources gives us the outlooks on the 2012 energy and auto markets. Then, on Book Talk, a roundtable discussion at a bookstore somewhere in suburban Maryland. Only on the new Comcast C-SPAN.
Joining us to discuss the level of political discourse in America is BBC's Lord Trevor Foblin, whose Letter from America has heard around the world. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you, Stephen. It's great to be here.
It's David.
David. I'm sorry. Who am I thinking of? Oh,
I'm doing Stephen Baldwin's show at 1:45. Let's not forget that. Thank you.
You're David
Feldman.
Stein.
Feldman.
Thank
you for joining us. Now, where are you speaking to us from today?
I am speaking from my home at Wessex-upon-Sussex.
It's a beautiful home. It was featured recently in Architectural Digest.
No. You're thinking of my estate in Sussex-upon-Wessex. This is my cottage in Wessex-upon-Sussex.
So that's your cottage?
Well, I call it a cottage. If you visited, you would call it... Well, you wouldn't get within 10 mile radius of Wessex-upon-Sussex because of, shall we say, where you were born or how you were born or the style of upbringing you had. Anyway, it's a magnificent cottage. It's an old Cecil Went estate. You're familiar with Cecil Went, the great 18th century industrialist?
I don't think so.
Yes, no, he's a marvelous man. I knew his daughter, son. And Cecil Went was the inventor of the migraine headache, which was all the rage until the war. And people said, wait a second, what's so grand about a migraine? Maybe a migraine is to be scoffed at. And it's so much fun to switch positions on things, to dislike something and like something. I mean, the hula hoop comes to mind, and I'm not sure why.
Let's talk about the level of political discourse here in the United States. We had a pretty tragic week here in America, and a lot of people are blaming it on the First Amendment.
Yes, Jersey Shore's premiered, I believe.
Right. That was pretty awful. But we also had something pretty tragic pretty tragic in Arizona, and a lot of people are blaming some of the radio personalities like Glenn Beck and Rush Limbaugh, who say that the right wing is revving up the crazies in this country. Does that happen in England? Do you have personalities on the BBC who try to get the conservative base riled up?
We have a woman named Lady Jane Hoffington Kingston Wilson, and she is a giant, giant fat woman. And even if it's possible, the fat can drip through the radio lines into your home. That's how fat she is. I've been known to turn the dial to that station and gain 3 kilos. So, I mean, this is, and now that is a different reason of dislike, because what she's exuding is everything that's unhealthy in nature, and she sizzles everything, fries everything in butter. I mean, not on the radio, but I mean, I know her personally. I dated her for a while, and she was very, very fun. She was free sexually. And I'm sorry, what's the question?
Well, she would be the equivalent of our Rush Limbaugh.
Yeah, so Rush Limbaugh is disgusting, I think, and I don't judge people. I hate judgment. But to me, he's Joe the Plumber if he had a community college degree.
And yet you were at his wedding. You were the one.
At his wedding. I was, I think he's in a way a marvelous man. He's one of the great American masters. And not just because he owns slaves. I think it's because he's specific to what he says, and that's why he's a hero. I like Rush Limbaugh.
And and it's because of you that Elton John sang at Rush's wedding.
That's right. Elton John is a dear, dear, dear friend of Rush's. And it's an unlikely duo, isn't it? But, I mean, that's the interesting unlikely duos that you have, John McCain and Sarah Palin. They were people that you didn't assume would be matched at all. And here they are. That's fun. You talking to me, I've never... the only time I've ever known someone like yourself, with all due respect, is if I was having a pair of pants altered.
You're in your cottage.
Well, it's a lovely cottage. It's we call it a Canterbury. It's an interesting story about Canterbury. The great Eddie Cantor buried his sister somewhere on the grounds here at Canterbury. The story goes. Well, I mean, it's a wonderful place. It's wonderful. It was owned originally by Sir Noel Coward, and beautiful rolling hills. In fact, on very quiet nights, if you listen carefully, you can almost hear Noel Coward's voice whispering in your ear, "Find out the name of the tall one." And many are frightened by these yelps, but I find it soothing. That's why this is where I do all my writing. I find that in order to reflect on one's life, I suppose, one needs solitude. Just me, my typewriter, my personal assistant, Stanley, my personal assistant, Stella, and the ghost of Eddie Cantor's sister, and of course her personal assistant who can't type for shit. And that irritates me, even in death.
For decades now, you've been explaining America to the world.
Yes.
And why do you think you, more than anybody else in the United Kingdom, and perhaps here in the States, why are you considered an expert at distilling the essence of such a complex place as America?
Well, I think it's because for a year and a half as a child, I was a hydrocephalic. And I think that anyone who has too much fluid on one's brain can look at a continent with a different perspective.
Mm-hmm.
I think America's a very unusual place, isn't it? I mean, you have all these people that despise each other, and they're constantly angry at each other, and they're spewing hatred on the radio, or the all the different ways, telegraph, or the modern approaches, I suppose, Morse code. And they're constantly saying negative, dreadful things about each other. And I look at someone like Glenn Beck, and I say, you can't expect more than a grunt from a pig.
And you don't have this rage in England the way we do. You're not as angry a country as America.
We're not angry because we're angry at the weather. My God, I mean, it snows here now. And so if we had a detainee, we'd snowboard him.
But you don't. You don't waterboard. You have guns. You have rifles.
Oh, my God. Yes, we have guns. We have pellet guns and guns with bullets. But we don't really harm each other.
Why is that?
We're not good shots.
Okay, time for Have Your Say USA, line one.
Hello, yes, this is Debbie.
Hi, Debbie, what say you?
Debbie, from Dr. Margolis' office.
Okay, Debbie, what's on your mind?
Dear, I'm looking at your records. It's been 6 months. Yes, 6 months since your last cleaning.
Oh, Debbie, right, from my dentist's office.
Yes, dear, this is Debbie from Dr. Margolis' office.
Debbie, this is my work line. Do you mind calling my home line? Thank you. Line five.
This is Debbie from Dr. Margolis' office.
Okay, I already told you to call my home phone.
Last time you were here, dear, we saw bleeding in the gums.
Line four.
The floor looked like a slaughterhouse. I should have worn a hazmat suit. I had flu-like symptoms for 4 days.
Debbie, please. Let's try line five.
Hello, this is Debbie from Dr. Margolis' office.
Line seven, you're on with David Feldman.
I'm looking at the calendar, David. We have an opening. Lucky you, 6 a.m. tomorrow morning.
Debbie,
is that too early?
Debbie.
David, please take your teeth seriously. At your age, you're lucky to have any at all.
I will make an appointment as soon as I'm off the air. Line four.
You always seem to like it when I'm scaling your back molars, David, and my breasts accidentally rub against you.
Line 11.
Why did you take the free dental floss and the tongue scraper?
Line 2.
If you didn't want to see me again, David.
Line 3.
I really care about your gums. I really care about them. Nobody's going to care about your gums like I do, David. I have an opening at 9. Come to Mama.
Line 4.
I was the one that told you about Sensodyne, David. Your teeth should rot in hell.
Line 7.
Hello. I'd like to talk about Egypt.
Yes. Go ahead, by all means. Thank you.
While I'm flossing your coffee-stained, plaque-riddled, beautiful teeth, I'm holding an x-ray, David, of your teeth. They're beautiful. I miss your teeth so much, and I can't control myself. Don't turn me away. It's a dental pick to my heart. I can come to your house. Please.
We're sorry. Your call cannot be completed as dialed. Please check the number and dial again, or call your operator to help you.
The new Comcast C-SPAN. You like meetings? So do we. Tonight at 9, the Senate Committee on Small Business asks, what if somebody's business is too small? Does size really matter? Then live from the Hart Office Building, what happens when members of the Senate Committee on Indian Affairs have affairs with Indians? Then at 10, on Washington Journal, Michelle Bachman. She lived in a bizarre world where up was down, wrong was right, and right was far right. Tonight, see Michelle Bachman's naked ambition, an unblinking look at a woman who never blinks. Michelle Bachman. She puts the C in CPAC. Then at 11, it's an all-new State Department daily briefing. It all happens tonight on the new Comcast C-SPAN.
Today, Hosni Mubarak resigned, which took us completely by surprise. We spoke to him just last night, and he couldn't have been more committed to staying in power. Now joining us from Cairo is Egypt's dictator, Hosni Mubarak. Thank you for joining us, Mr. Dictator.
Oh, please call me dictator.
You know, there's much to talk about, dictator.
Yes, but let's keep it short. Fallon's got Aziz Ansari tonight. Very funny man.
I don't mean to correct you, sir, but Aziz Ansari isn't Egyptian. He's Pakistani.
Close enough. Look, if you want me to wait until Fallon has an Egyptian comic on, believe me, I'll retire before that ever happens. You see, because I'll never retire.
How are you? Many of your people were disappointed after you refused to retire this week.
Retire to what? That's not Hosni Mubarak style. Not for me. I like to stay busy. I live to oppress, and I oppress to live. You want me to end up like my uncle Tanous? That man had a successful business selling car batteries to extraordinary rendition sites throughout Syria's tri-state area. His children talk him into selling their company. They move him to Sharm el Sheikh. Within 2 days, he suffers a massive stroke. Now, David, he sits and talks to a potted plant in his living room. Sad story deserves a sad rim shot.
But, sir, 30 years is a long time to rule your people. They hunger for change.
Hunger is funny. They'll hunger for a lot more than change if they don't get back to work, okay? Message clear. I get it. Enough already with the 2 million taking to the streets. Hey, by the way, how about Israel? Pretty horrible country, right?
You've been a very strong ally to Israel.
Yes, of course. I'm just saying Jews are a horrible, horrible people. You know, I'm afraid...
I don't understand why you're bringing up Israel now.
Because it's convenient. I am afraid, when in doubt,
yes,
on Israel. David, I'm afraid that with all the talk about corruption and torture and zero democracy, that we're losing sight of what a dreadful group of people the Jews are.
Why do you think your people suddenly hate you after 30 years?
A very good question. Maybe I stole a little too much. I oppressed a little too much. Maybe I took a little too big a bite out of life. Flew a little too close to the sun. Hosni Mubarak kept his feet on the ground while he reached for the stars.
I watch you on television. There are millions of people on the streets who want to pull a Ceausescu.
Gesundheit.
Aren't you frightened? I notice your hands don't shake. How are you able to hold up under this kind of pressure?
I couldn't do it without the rape and support of my wife. If you're listening, honey, leave the light on. I'm coming home.
Tonight, on the new Comcast C-SPAN, on a very special Washington Journal, they're beautiful, they're bad, they're flat-out dangerous. Sarah Palin and Michelle Bachmann, together in one conference room. It's game on. Can you say catfight? Then at 8, it's an all-new National Prayer Breakfast. Then, the Senate Committee on Appropriations gets inappropriate. Then, tonight at 9, on the Senate Rules Committee, they're breaking all the rules. The new Comcast C-SPAN. You like meetings? So do we.
Italian Prime Minister Silvio Berlusconi is in some trouble due to allegations of underage sex with a prostitute. For more on this, we turn to the BBC's Lord Trevor Foblin. The BBC's Lord Trevor Piglington Foblin now joins us from Italy. Thank you for being with us.
The pleasure is mine, but mostly yours.
Lord Foblin, what are you doing in Rome?
Come here, darling. Come. Camilla, my Yorkie is humping my leg in missionary position.
And her name is Camilla. So, what are you doing in Rome this week?
Well, I mean, I was dying for some Nobu, and so I had it flown in from Los Angeles. And I found it more fun to dine exclusively in another city that does not have the restaurant, but you fly the food in.
So you're in Rome, and you're filming a new 13-part series for the BBC.
That's right. I'm putting the finishing touch on my new 13-part series for the BBC about the rise and fall of the Roman Empire, entitled Eat, Pray, Purge.
Let's talk about Silvio Berlusconi. Silvio Berlusconi, the Prime Minister... The Silvio Berlusconi, the Prime Minister of Italy.
Oh, yes. He's here now. Would you like to speak to him?
Sure.
Silvio, put Camilla down, darling.
I think they're having a moment. He got confused. He asked me the dog's age, and I said 11, and he thought he was literally 11 in a child's age, and he's been very, very, very attentive.
Well, you bring up an interesting point. The Italian Prime Minister, Silvio Berlusconi, now faces trial, possibly, for engaging in underage sex.
I think the problem with Silvio right now is overage sex. Have you seen the dear lad without his Spanx? Not pretty. And I did a workout with him yesterday, and literally his socks slipped down and I saw the tip of his...
But it's inappropriate. She is underage. She's...
Oh, aren't we the prude?
Here in America, we have our own sex scandal. What do you make of this New York congressman forced to resign, Chris Lee?
Yes, he was wonderful in Dracula, wasn't he? And I think he's dating Whoopi Goldberg, which is, he's clearly a sucker for a woman with no eyebrows.
No, you're thinking of Frank Langella. Frank Langella dated Whoopi... No, Frank Langella dated Whoopi Goldberg.
Possible to know that a man who could be so effective as Richard Nixon could then serve in Congress and at the same time say Whoopi Goldberg's my lady.
No, Congressman Chris Lee.
Yes, yes, Asian boy.
I was talking about the congressman from New York, forced to resign Wednesday after posting a shirtless photo of himself on Craigslist. He was trying to date women.
Yes. Well, I found that shocking, now that I know who I'm talking about. I saw the photos of this man, Chris Lee, and not only is the man buff, but he's into straight sex and knows how the internet works. And I was shocked, because how could a man possibly be a Republican? If you see what I've done.
That's very funny, sir.
Thank you, thank you.
You do it all, sir.
Thank you, thank you.
Is there anything you can't do? That's what I've often wondered.
I can't, for the life of me, auto f***.
And you've tried.
Doing it as we speak.
But you're not succeeding.
Almost.
Apparently Speaker Boehner has zero tolerance for this kind of behavior.
But you do know about John Boehner's liaisons. Do you not, his liaisons?
No, I don't.
Well, Washington is simply a buzz with the National Enquirer. Latest revelation about Boehner's two mistresses.
With all due respect, sir, it's the National Enquirer.
Yes, 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 but they were the first ones to report that John Edwards' love child existed, and they were right about Monica Lewinsky, and everyone thought they were going to get sued after breaking the story about Ray Romano's sex change operation. And I think she looks marvelous. I mean, the Adam's apple doesn't work, and it's still the face of a longshoreman, but with the long hair and the fake breasts that are now real, I can look at that at night and I can feel tingling where I have not felt tingling for ages.
Wait, you're saying John Edwards had a love child?
Yes. Oh my God, and it was broken. It's been all over the press. And now we hear that the Speaker of the House cheats on his wife. Trust me on this one, my dear, dear John-like boy. 2011 will be the year of Boehner's boner.
You've met every powerful leader of the 20th century, early 21st century. Is there such thing as a powerful leader who remains faithful to his wife?
Well, I think you have to look at the former Archbishop Joseph Ratzinger, the present Pope. He's been very loyal to his dear friend Siegfried. And this is a time when Roy was really making a play for him.
Thanks for listening. Today's show was written by Ben Zelovansky, Steve Rosenfield, Ned Rice, Andrea Martin, and Ray James. Today's show featured Martin Short, Andrea Martin, Robert Smigel, Mark Thompson, Dana Gould, Steph Zamorano, Troy Conrad, and Jane Edith Wilson. I'm David Feldman. Please friend me on Facebook to hear a rebroadcast of this show, or for some additional materials and old podcasts, please visit davidfeldmancomedy.com, and while you're over there, join our mailing list. From the KPFK studios in Southern California, I'm David Feldman, reminding you that if you have room in your home and your heart, run down to the nearest shelter and adopt the ugliest cat or dog you can find.